Next, Rick Pennell.
Tom, come on up here. You just stand here, Tom. You know, today I'm gonna introduce somebody who's the true definition of a friend, a role model for a healthy retirement, and a true unsung hero, Tom Oliva. This is Tom here, in case you didn't guess. Tom greets everyone with a smile and a greeting. I mean everyone. There is no strangers to Tom Oliva. At Christmas, he walks around with lights blinking around his neck. His friends and family frequently are shaking their heads when you see Tom in action. Example, when he was in Europe last year, you know, you see these statues that are real people? Tom goes in front of them and does magic tricks to see if he can get them to move. This is just the beginning. I could go on a whole program on Tom and his theatrics. When Tom meets a stranger, a longtime friend, he's totally focused on them. He wants to know everything about his new friends, and some of you would call them strangers. Tom knows no strangers. Tom makes everyone feel seen and valued. Whether you're 5 or 85, in hospice or in jogger, a new acquaintance or a longtime friend, Tom will be there for you. If his friends were not even able to communicate, Tom will go and spend time with them, just sitting quietly with them. Tom's career was 30 years with the YMCA. In the last 12 years, he ran Aspire that we were involved in, and he retired 5 years ago. On Sundays, you're going to find Tom teaching Sunday school with 3- and 6-year-olds at Grace of Christ Church, as he has done for decades. On Tuesdays, you're going to see Tom volunteering at the Greenway, running around his golf cart, handing out water and greeting everyone. Kelly Condon, who couldn't be here today, said, "Tom is the best. All the Greenway staff love Tom." Well, let's not forget the Greenway dogs. When Tom is driving his car in the Greenway, all the dogs know Tom is driving because Tom always has treats for his four-legged friends. During the week until COVID, Tom spent time each week at a pediatrician's offices doing his magic tricks, making the kids forget about their illnesses or the shot they're about to get. Well, many days of the week, you'll also find Tom at Adams School reading and teaching to normally just 2 kids. He reads to them, and then he helps them read to him. Plus, sometimes he does his magic tricks. Tom loves it when he arrives at Adams. The kids come in and ring up and call, "Mr. Tom, Mr. Tom." That is how he's known at Adams. Special education classes are his favorites. They love Tom's magic. I'm going to just read something. I got a text just before I came. This is from the principal, Jose Contreras, at Adams. "Thank you for recognizing Mr. Oliva and the unsung hero. We know him here as the El Gran Mago, which in Spanish is the great magician. He's an amazing guy, making an impact on lives of many students and staff." Also here today is Doug Tlepicki, who's representing Adams. And Doug, we thank you for coming. He just wanted to, they want to have a representative here from Adams to thank Tom for what he's done for them. At Christmas, Tom is at Adams as a Santa and planning their Christmas party. This year, he's also at Rod's house doing the same. You know, today I'm only including some of the highlights of Tom's activities he does frequently. I'm not listing all the last minute or the call-ups that he gets to come and do something to help somebody else. A person whose total life is all about helping people feel better about themselves, you'll always feel better and leave with a smile after talking to Tom Oliva. Mr. Tom Oliva, a true unsung hero. So, Tom, the Rotary Club of Yakima honor You, with an unsung hero word, you truly exemplify Rotary's motto, service above self. Thank you, Tom, for all you do for all of us and for our community. And from 5 to 85-year-olds, you're our hero.
And I'm on the upper end of that.
And I can say thank you.
Okay. I've got 30 seconds. I just want to thank Rotary. Humbly thank you for this award. And even more, I want to thank Rotary for all the projects that you sponsor in the community to help Yakima be a better place to live. And I'm recipient of that when I worked with the Aspire program. That was just one of the many great programs you have sponsored. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you, Rick.
Thank you.
Go Cougs.
We're going to just move on to the program today. They've complained, both of them, that you expect me to do this in 10 minutes each. Yep, that's what I expect. So let me talk about the program today. The Camino de Santiago is famously known as the Way of St. James. It is no ordinary journey. The total walk is 500 miles. The iconic pilgrimage, steeped in medieval charm, draws people from all walks of life to the stunning cathedral of Santiago de Compostela, located in Spain's northeast corner. The routes are a network of many different paths, with everyone choosing their own path, all leading to the city of Santiago de Compostela. Each route has its own history, heritage, and charm, with a route for every interest and ability. Our members, Salisa Hopkins and Russ and Nancy Mazzola, will tell their stories. Why did they take this walk? What they learned from the walk? The trials and tribulations of such a journey? Both Salisa and Mazzola started at very different paths. Just for your knowledge, Salisa is George Brown, our member's daughter. And I don't know, did you choose who was going first, or is Salisa going first? They're going first. Okay, the Mazzolas, come on up and welcome.
Russ's cane is just from a total knee replacement. So over the last month, I've gone from Florence Nightingale to Nurse Ratchet, taking care of him. I want to start by giving a little bit of the history. St. James the Apostle is the patron saint of Spain. It was known that he did preach in the early church in Spain. He returned to Jerusalem, where he was martyred. And then about the first century, it is believed that his remains were brought back to Spain, where he was buried. And his burial point near the Terra Fenista was kept secret because the Romans were in charge, and they weren't very favorable to the early church. So about 1850, they felt the Christians were enough of a presence that they felt they could rebury him in the town of Compostela, and they built a church around his tomb, which by the 12th century became a cathedral, and of course it was added on to, and that's the cathedral that's there today. There are 9 recognized routes to the cathedral, and the reason that there were many pilgrims who traveled to Jerusalem, Rome, and then also to the burial place of St. James. And they did this for many reasons, for spiritual reasons, sometimes for atonement, and sometimes certain crimes would qualify that if you made this journey, you could avoid jail. Sometimes rich people would pay others to take their place. The earliest guidebook was written in about 1150. And it was a 5-volume that gave the history of the Caminos. It gave advice on what to visit and where to go, and even to how to avoid scams and bad food. So I wanted to do something for my 70th birthday, and so I wanted an adventure and decided to do the Camino. I had not talked to anybody that had gone on the Camino, but I read a lot about it, and I determined that I wanted to be as much like the early pilgrims as I could, except I wasn't going to beg my way through Spain. But I was determined to carry everything that I needed on my back for the 500 plus miles, and that I would trust in the Lord to find a place for me to lay my head at night. And that worked really well until one day it didn't. And so then I quickly learned how to make a local phone call in Spain. And from time to time, if I thought we were in a bottleneck, we would call ahead a few hours. And so I wanted to say that Russ was not as excited about this adventure as I was.
So shortly before we went on the Camino, we went to a meeting of folks who had done the Camino and folks that were interested in doing the Camino in Portland. And I remember very clearly one chap talking to me, and when he learned that I had not made up my mind whether to go or not, and I told him that I was thinking just accompanying my wife, he said, no, absolutely, you've got to make the decision on your own. You can't accompany somebody just because you're going to keep them company. But that turned out not to be true for me. I don't know where I sit on a spirituality schedule or continuum, probably at least a five. So that had some attraction to me. The other part, I really felt I needed to support Nancy to be with her. And as I told Jerry McGree a couple weeks ago, in all candor, I didn't know whether I wanted to be celibate for the period of time she was gone. So the night that our first stop was in Roncha Villa, which is just on the west side of the Pyrenees. When we got there, we checked in, went out for a pilgrim meal, and then decided we were going to go to Mass. And in the Catholic faith, there's before the Gospel, there's the Alleluia that's normally sung or read. We were in a church that was built in the 11th or 12th century. I looked that up, so I'm not exactly certain, but it was old. And during the Alleluia, I just remember being just a phenomenal feeling of being overwhelmed and having this connectedness with just all mankind. It was just a phenomenal feeling. And the priest who said the Mass was kind of celebrated by three or four priests. They were very talented linguistically because they welcomed everybody in about seven or eight languages. There were probably about 200 people, pilgrims, in that Mass. And that if I had to leave the Camino the next day, it would have been worth it.
Okay, you can tell about that day.
You were going to talk about the albergues.
Oh, I just wanted to say we mostly stayed in albergues, which are big dormitories, and everything is co-ed. And I do want to say Europeans are much less modest than we are about changing and showering next to males and whatnot. And there are many middle-aged and older European men who should not wear bikini underwear.
So,
Quick.
Yeah. And our day would usually start off at about 7:30, 8 o'clock. The night before, that morning, we'd buy some fresh fruit or vegetables. We'd walk for an hour and a half to 2 hours, take a break. Nancy would get a cafe and a large croissant. I would just get some type of pastry and hot chocolate. We'd then pick up the pace again, walk to noon, get a noon meal, and start off again and walk probably 3 to 4 hours, probably to 4:30, 5 o'clock. When we check into another albergue, normally we'd end up washing our clothes first, then end up showering, go to a pilgrim meal, and then if there was a Mass, we'd end up going.
Okay. So we were lucky that two of our sons were able to join us for a small, less than a week while we were on the trip. And so our oldest son, Mark, did a two-minute video. It's called Walking Through Galatia in 2 Minutes. And we just wanted to share that with you to sort of get an idea of what it looked like. Although this is quite level. There were places that were quite mountainous, and it was a rigorous day. But these days were pretty easy as far as the walking.
And the meals that we had, these pilgrim meals, the country was really tuned in to catering to the tourists or pilgrims. So normally you could get a euro at that time was probably about $1.30 in U.S. currency. You could get a pilgrim meal somewhere between 5 to 10 euros, and it would consist of a bottle of wine, loaf of bread, a main course, a salad first, then a main course, and a dessert. Just really well done and orchestrated in the country. Okay. So, Carolyn, if you want to play that video.
Hopefully we're right side up.
When we downloaded this last night, it was tilted at 90 degrees, but it looks like that's okay.
We didn't walk that fast.
The symbol of the Camino is a shell, and that's how you would know where you were going. There'd be, especially in municipal areas, they'd have on the outside of buildings shells, and you just, that's how you would guide you on the route. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's been almost 9 years since I took this journey, but as I prepared for today and went back through and read through my journal entries and looked at the photographs from the trip, it brought me right back to the essence of what that trip gave me, what the Camino gave me, and even just listening to Russ and Nancy, I can feel all of that just kind of come back up again. The Camino taught me many lessons about life. I think it's a very symbolic journey. And before I took the walk, someone had said to me, the first third is physical, the second third is mental, and the last third is spiritual. They call it a pilgrimage for a good reason, and it's indeed sacred and spiritual, and something happens to you despite whatever your intention is for going. I walked with my sister, my mom, and a dear friend. There were four of us, and my sister was really the one who was the catalyst for the trip. She loves to travel, and about 4 months prior to our departure, she convinced the other three of us that it was a good idea to walk 156 miles with her. And I had never done anything like that, but I was a walker. I would walk most mornings, and I'm a hiker, and so I thought, not a big deal. I can do this. I didn't really train for it. I really figured I'd be fine. And what I don't do on a regular basis is walk with 20-plus pounds on my back, and that makes a difference. The first few days, the physical discomfort was indeed very present. My feet hurt at night. My feet would swell, and they were really itchy. My neck and my shoulders ached from the weight of the pack, which I was very aware of. And although my body was extremely exhausted, it was not unusual to find the four of us awake in the middle of the night, giggling and unable to sleep. I'm not sure what that was about, but that's what happened. And I'm sure our dorm mates in those albergs didn't always appreciate our giggling. We carried what we needed in our backpacks. Similarly, we had, we stayed places, so we didn't need to carry sleep mats, but we carried sleeping bags or a sleep sack, pillow, your water, whatever clothes you needed. First aid kits, lots of Band-Aids for those blisters you will inevitably get. And pretty quickly you recognize that it does not serve you well to carry anything you don't need. And I think it's very true in life. Like, we letting go of the things that aren't serving us, that aren't helping us, allows us to walk through the world much lighter, much freer. And that was apparent very early on. I think we all were ditching things. All of the places where we would stay had these little deposits where pilgrims would leave the stuff that they didn't want to carry with them any longer. One of the things I treasured about this experience was, similarly to Russ and Nancy, we didn't really have a plan. We knew where we started. We did the Portuguese coastal route, and we started in Porto, Portugal, and we knew where we were starting. We knew we were ending in Santiago, but we didn't really know where we were staying each night. We did not have reservations. We didn't actually even use our phones to follow GPS ourselves where we were going. We trusted that those yellow scallop shells that are the symbol of the Camino, that would get us where we needed to go. And there were many times when we would think we were lost, and just when you think, okay, have we made a wrong turn? We need to get help. You would come across either the yellow arrow or the scallop shell. And I think that yellow scallop shell is quite symbolic in that it's, all of these lines that come to the same place. And it's much like how we all take varied paths in life, but ultimately we all end up at the same place. Walking the Camino was one of those experiences that it really takes on a life of its own. And it's a kind of journey where you learn what you're made of, what you do in the face of adversity, how you handle suffering and challenge. And you really also get to see the best of others. There is such a community of spirit on the Camino, not only the pilgrims that are walking it, but also all the people that you encounter. I felt like I was the most generous version of myself with the people I was with, and there's just something that happens. I want to share a couple of stories that, for me, really illustrate that. About halfway into our journey, my sister's feet were so blistered that her feet were just raw. We would joke that they looked like raw meat, and they did. And so somebody advised us to go see a pharmacist. We had made our way into Spain by that point, and their pharmacist would help provide a little bit of medical care. So we, first thing this one morning, head into the pharmacy, and the pharmacist is cleaning her feet and irrigating these wounds and giving us medication and first aid supplies. And as we're getting ready to leave, the pharmacist looks at her and says, "You cannot put hiking shoes, back on these feet. You are at such risk for infection. These blisters are so terrible. You need to wear open-toed shoes." Well, we didn't have open-toed hiking shoes with us, so we leave the pharmacy and set out to find a sporting goods store or an REI. Well, they don't have those in tiny villages in Spain. So we found the nearest shoe store. My sister found this pair of, it was kind of like a Birkenstock type shoe, had a couple straps across and then leather strap across the back, and they were not comfortable, but she made it through the rest of that day. And that evening, we stayed at an albergue and met this older Australian couple, and they were traveling with this young woman from Russia named Olka. I get choked up. even talking about it today. But so we shared with them about our journey and our struggles and about my sister's feet. They were a hot topic of conversation, it seemed like, no matter what we were doing. And head to bed that night. And in the morning, we left very early. We'd try and head out right about at sunrise and sneak out of the dormitory area and are gathering our things together in the lobby. And Olka, the 19-year-old Russian girl, appears, and she's holding a pair of hiking sandals. And she says to my sister, "These have been in my backpack my whole journey, and they will be much happier walking the Camino on your feet." And remarkably enough, they were my sister's size, and that is what she completed the rest of her journey with, was in Olka's shoes. I don't think she's ever gotten rid of them either. I think they're prized possession. Another day we were walking. It was one of the hottest days we'd walked, and as we're walking, we're all hot, tired, thirsty, hungry, and it's quite a ways to our next stop. And there was, I just remember very distinctly, there was this rock wall that was about hip height next to us. And on the other side of that was farmland and some sporadic houses. And as we're walking, we see this beautiful, very ripe orange tree. And the oranges are hanging down, and they're kind of on the side of our side of the rock wall and providing a little shade. So we stopped for a little respite. And as we're discussing whether or not it would be appropriate to grab a few of the oranges, we hear this woman yelling and look, and this woman is coming out of this house and she's waving her hands and very animated. And we think, oh crap, she's going to yell at us for trying to steal her oranges. But no, she invited us to come into her yard. She gave us as many oranges as we were willing to carry with us for the rest of our day. She gave us water. She gave us pain de chocolat, like chocolate croissants, and let us sit as long as we needed to. And that was just, it happened everywhere. And it felt like the universe was conspiring to help us make the journey. A few days into the walk, my mind definitely shifted away from my physical body and really became more about the way that I walk through the world. As I said, I felt like the most generous version of myself. I felt like the strongest version of myself, happy, free. And I remember I kept pondering, like, how does walking 15 to 20 miles a day do this to you? What is it about this walking that makes me feel like such the best version of me? And what I recognized was that in that journey, you start to peel back the layers of yourself. You let go of expectations, of the I shoulds, the responsibilities, the negativity. You just get down to your basics. And as we journeyed, it became clear to me really what that was for me. Loving others and feeling loved, being present in the moment, seeing beauty and finding joy in what is, even in the midst of suffering. Compassion, laughter, generosity, kindness, strength, teamwork, perseverance. I wrote a poem on the Camino that for me sums this up best, and that's what I'll leave you with. I begin the walk and move as quick as my feet will carry me, passing strangers along the way, greeting them with hello and good day. As I journey, the windows of my eyes and the door of my heart open wide. Others walk alongside me. I smile and keep moving forward. And then I begin to see it is me I pass by and walk beside. I am everyone I meet. My heart floods with love. I slow down and sing. I belong to you. You belong to me. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you so much. What a wonderful journey. I could have listened to you guys talk for 10, 15, 20 more minutes, and you've inspired me. Yeah, yeah. You've inspired me to look into doing that. I mean, what a beautiful journey and experience that you guys have had, and thank you so much for sharing that with us. I would love to see more pictures, and the video was fantastic. Yeah, we do. We have time for questions. Does anybody have any questions? Okay.
We went the latter part. We went the latter part of May, early June, and we ended up. Thank you. I had a major trial
about 2 weeks after we were getting back the first year. So we did it in 2 years. We did about 250 miles, 300 miles the first year, and then finished the second year. And the second year, we were roughly in that same time frame, middle of the summer.
Similar time frame, early May is when we did it.
Well, interesting. Interesting. Oh, the question was, I obviously have knee surgery now. How was the knee on the trip? I had a clean out on my right knee, and we didn't do the Pyrenees on the first year. I did it on the second year. We just wanted to make sure we completed all the legs, and I didn't have any problem the first year. The second year, interesting enough, the right leg, which I had cleaned out the year before, really troubled me going down the backside of the Pyrenees, going downhill. But that was the only time it bothered me the second year. You don't have a knee operation.
Hi, guys. Thank you, all three of you, for a wonderful presentation. I could literally sit here and listen to it all over again. It was phenomenal. If you had advice for others in preparation, for your preparation, what would you do differently?
Jan, for me, I had some serious foot problems, not as bad as Salisa's sister, but I got my feet infected, ended up going to the hospital. But the second year I learned, I'm one of those people that have their second toe is bigger than their first toe, and I learned how to lace my boots up through with the assistance of someone at REI. That really helped me keep the first part of the boot loose and then tighten up on the ankle up. So that's the only thing, Jan, for me, was the foot issues.
I didn't have any issues, I don't think. I was very well prepared because Russ would say I was anal about my preparation because I would take out the kitchen scale and I brought two short sleeve shirts and I actually weighed them to make sure, which, you know, only took the lightest things. And it was cold in the morning and most people had wool gloves. Well, I just wore my extra pair of wool socks on my hands. I wasn't even going to pay, you know, bring an extra pair of gloves. So,
and as Celicia mentioned, the recommendation is you not carry more than 10% of your body weight, but that I was not impacted by that at all. It didn't bother me.
I don't know that I really would have done anything different. I think that you very quickly, like, your body gets used to it, and it's painful in the beginning, and then, but I think that you adjust to it fairly quickly. And yeah, lightening your load is about the only preparation advice I would give.
How long did it take you guys?
Well, for me, we did, it was 11 days that we were on the trail and walked anywhere from 15 to 20 miles a day. We did 156 miles total.
Our average is about the same. I'd say closer to maybe 17 miles a day. And we did it, as I mentioned, in two different trips. The total was to be about 510 miles, something like that. And we basically cut that in half in each of the 2 years.
Yes, that's. Did you ever not feel safe?
No, we never did not feel safe. Although, sadly, the second year, there was a girl that came up missing from, who by serendipity happened to be from the same area of my daughter-in-law's from in Arizona. And unfortunately, she was found murdered. It took a period of time for the police to discover where her body was, but she had been abducted by a local Spaniard. Rick. We did, but I had that, because of limitation of time, I didn't go into the detail that I think Celicia did a great job of explaining how it moved her. I had that same feeling, especially, we had several instances where you'd just be overwhelmed by just the connectedness with humanity. I lost track of your question. Give it to me again.
What
Celeste did a great job explaining what changed with her. What changed with you, because I know you went with different expectations, but what changed with you and on the journey, if anything?
Yeah, I think just, Nancy just said the awareness of people. I think just the openness to new experiences, the openness to meeting, to developing new relationships. The wonderful part of the Camino is that you would start off walking, you'd meet somebody on the Camino, not other than Nancy, of course, and you'd walk with them for a day, maybe. You'd lose track of them, and two or three days, you'd run into them again, and you'd walk with them again. So it was a wonderful way to develop relationships and interact with people. And I think that growing love of the world is something that I experienced.
I would say the same. We met one woman whose name was Grace, and she was not particularly religious at all, but she said, look at this. We've got the wheat on one side of the trail, and we've got the grapes on the other. She said, we're walking through communion. So it was very...
I think you heard enough from me about that.
Are you still in touch with people that you've met?
Jerry, we met two delightful guys from England the first year. And this is an amazing story for me. We got their email addresses, and we kiddingly said, okay, we're coming back next year. They were doing 2 weeks at a time. They ferried their car over from Great Britain, and their wives were driving on the same route, but driving a car. They would meet the guys in the evening, and they were staying. They were doing an high end. We were doing at the opposite end of the spectrum. But the second year, so we lost track of them, sadly. And I may have told you this, Jerry. By the way, Jerry and his brothers did the Camino this year. We were checking into a hotel. In the movie The Way, Martin Sheen is one of the main characters, and he develops a relationship with some other pilgrims, and he treats them to a night in, was it Lyon? Anyway, in a large city at a very, very upscale hotel. So we decided we were going to stay in this hotel because we'd been doing it on the cheap for so long, and it was near our anniversary. So I'm checking into the hotel. I lost track with the two guys. I'm checking into the hotel, and all of a sudden I hear a voice behind me says, that's a familiar accent. Our two friends and their wives were checking out of the hotel to go to lunch, and we reconnected with them. And they've been to the United States to stay with us. We've been to England twice to visit them. That's and the gal that Nancy was talking about, Grace, we met with them two times, but not lately. Tom, congratulations, by the way.
Fantastic. One more round of applause. This doesn't fit in there. All right, who's inspired to do this now? Let's get a group together and do it, right? Will you guys be our guides? Well, thank you again. And in honor of your speech here, the gift that we're giving is a donation to Northwest Harvest in honor of all three of you to support food insecurity in our community. Thank you. Now, I want to mention the next few weeks' programs. Next week, we have Todd Keplin from Forge Youth Mentoring. Following that week, we have a panel discussion about intimate partner and domestic violence with several leaders in our community that will be talking about that. And then the week after that, we'll have Debbie Horton and Graham Tobias, the Johnny Cash, the official concert experience. So I encourage all of our Rotarians to join us the next few weeks, and all of our guests as well. If those sound interesting to you, please come back and join us. Have a good afternoon, and thank you again to our wonderful speakers. Our meeting is adjourned.